Hey class, today we're going to be talking about section 6.22 in AP Stats, which is inferences about means. So we've done hypothesis testing and confidence interval for proportions. In this chapter, we're going to be looking at hypothesis testing and confidence intervals for means. A lot of it's going to overlap. There's a little bit of differences. All right, so the first thing, just a review, the sampling distribution of x bar, so our sample mean, is that the mean of all the means, so the mu of x bar, is going to equal the mu in our theoretical sampling distribution. The standard deviation of all of our means is the standard deviation sigma of the population divided by the n, which is our sample size. And actually, that's wrong, sorry. We've got the standard deviation divided by the square root of n. Whoops, forgot my square root. Sorry about that. All right, and then the third one, the sampling distribution of x bar is approximately normal if n is at least 30, or if it is known that the population distribution is normal. So for one sample hypothesis, t-test for mu. In general, when we test a claim about a population mean, H naught is going to equal the hypothesized value, so they'll give you some sort of value in the problem. And our alternate hypothesis is that mu is going to be greater than or less than or not equal to that hypothesized value. Conditions for the one sample hypothesis t-test for mu are going to be very similar to our conditions for our one sample hypothesis z-test for p. We have randomization condition and independence condition, and we can use the 10% rule. To do that. So this is just independence within our one sample. Or you can use context, so 10% rule or context. And then we need the sampling distribution of X bar to be approximately normal. And again, we're going to go up here and use this rule here to accomplish that. Now, why is it all of a sudden a t-test? So we've been seeing z-scores and z-distributions for this whole course, up until right now. Now we're going to look at the t-distribution. And we don't always use the t-distribution when we're doing hypothesis testing for means, but most of the time we do because we often are not given the population standard deviation. And that's really the only way to tell if you're going to use z or t for your tests for means. So if you do not have the population standard deviation, then we have to use the standard deviation for our sample, which is S. And thus, it's not quite as accurate as if we had the population distribution. So we have to kind of balance out for that. So we're going to use, oops, sorry, I'm going to grab my formula sheet here. We're going to use the T curve. So in your formula packet for AP Stats, if you look, there's two pages for the Z curve, and then there's a page for the T curve, the T distribution. And if you look on the very first column, this says DF on the top, and that's going to be degrees of freedom. And that's based on your sample size. So depending on how big your sample is, the larger your sample gets, the closer you get to what these Z values actually are, which is at the bottom where it says infinity, if we had infinitely many degrees of freedom. Anyways, okay, so degrees of freedom is N minus one. So make sure to memorize that. Your degrees of freedom is always your sample size minus one. All right, on the next page, we have important properties of T distribution. So first, T-distributions begin when the degree of freedom is small with greater spread. So they're more spread out. So this would be an example of a T-curve with a small degrees of freedom. Notice it's kind of flatter versus a T-curve with a larger degrees of freedom, which is closer to a Z-curve. Two is the number of degrees of freedom increases, the spread decreases. So again, it gets more compact. And as degrees of freedom approach infinity, the spread of the corresponding t-distribution approaches the properties of the standard normal curve, which is our z-curve. Example one, a coffee machine dispenses coffee into paper cups. You're supposed to get 10 ounces of coffee, but the amount varies slightly from cup to cup. The amounts measured in a random sample of 20 cups are given. Identify the condition that is not met in order to conduct an inference about the population mean volume of coffee dispensed. And I think that's not supposed to be there. Okay. So if we look at this and we think about all of our conditions, if I count these numbers here, I have a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 by 1, 2, 3, 4. So my sample size is 20. And unfortunately, that sample size is too small to assume that the sampling distribution of X bar is approximately normal. And we don't know anything about the population distribution of our ounces of coffee in the coffee cups. So we don't know that the population distribution is normal. We can't say that it's normal based on our sample size. So we have a problem here. This is where the nearly normal condition comes in. The lack of definitely having a sample distribution that is approximately normal can be overlooked if the histogram of the specific sample we are analyzing is reasonably symmetric and unimodal without strong skewness or outliers. So remember, we do need to sketch our histogram in order to do this. So number two, example two says verify that the nearly normal condition is satisfied. So make sure you have your graphing calculators ready. We're going to go to Stat, Edit, and then as you can see, I've already typed in these numbers, so you may need to pause the video and type them in. So these are numbers from our table here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to just graph the histogram. So I'm going to go up to my stat plots. I'm going to turn my first plot on, make sure all my other plots are off. If you end up with a dimension mismatch error, it's usually because you accidentally left one of your other plots on. So I'm going to turn that on. I'm going to make sure that this is at the histogram and that my X list is L1 for this list of data. So now I'm going to go graph it. And that graph was from a different thing that I was doing earlier. So I'm going to just go to Zoom and I'm going to go down to the ninth one, which is Zoom Stat. All right, so here's my histogram. What we want to do is sketch a quick picture of that. It doesn't have to be perfect. It doesn't actually need to be labeled because all we're doing is looking at the shape. So we can kind of quickly, roughly, draw this histogram. Okay. So the histogram of the sample data is reasonably symmetric. I know it's not perfectly symmetric, but it's not super strongly skewed either. It is unimodal with no obvious outliers. Thus, the nearly normal, make sure you use the word nearly, nearly normal condition is satisfied. Example three. This is kind of a long lesson, so stay with me. A company claims its batteries last over 5 hours or 300 minutes in continuous use. A test of 12 batteries measured the following lifespans in minutes. So we have this list of data. Is there evidence the company's claim is true at a 10% significance level? So the first thing we want to do is define our parameter. Mu is the true mean or the population mean lifespan in minutes of batteries made by the company. Make sure you have units in your definition. So here, remember, we're doing means. So our numbers, our data, we actually have numbers with data, with units. It's numerical data, unlike when we did proportions, where we were just looking at like categorical data. Yes, no questions. How many people said yes? And we had a proportion. This is different now. So there's a few things you need to make sure to do. Make sure you say true mean or population mean. Make sure you have your units in there and, of course, context. Now, my null hypothesis. They are claiming that the batteries last over 5 hours. So they're saying that the mean is more than 300 minutes. So this is their claim. All right, so then the opposite of that would be less than or equal to. Now remember, we usually just see an equal to here, but this is really less than or equal to 300. And technically, we can write less than or equal to for our null, but we don't usually. We usually just put the equals. All right, my conditions. And now I know this is a lot of writing, so you might need to pause the video and kind of copy this all down so that you can really listen to me instead of trying to write it all down really fast. All right, so conditions for a one sample t-test from you. So remember, we do need to name our test at some point. I like to just put it right there where the conditions are. One, We will assume that the sample of 12 batteries is representative of all batteries made by the company. This is because if you reread it, they didn't say that they tested 12 randomly selected batteries, unfortunately. They did not randomly select it. I don't have randomization. I can't assume there was randomization, but what I can do is just say I'm going to have to assume that those batteries are representative of all of the batteries that are made by the company. Now, it is definitely reasonable to assume that 12 is less than 10% of all batteries made by the company. They probably made more than 120 batteries. So independence within the sample is assumed. Now, N equals 12. Darn it. This is less than 30. So the sample size is too small to assume the sampling distribution of X bar is approximately normal. But if we do the histogram, which we have to do, we can't just assume, we need to graph it. So I'm going to go to stat, edit, and then I've already typed in these numbers. Again, pause the video, type them in really quick. So once we have the numbers, I'm going to leave them in L2. I need to go back up to my stat plots, go into my plot one, and I have to change this to L2 because I used L2. All right, so now I'm going to go back to zoom and stat, and here's my new histogram. I'm going to draw a quick sketch of this. So we have this and this, and this goes up. All right, so there is my histogram sketch. And that histogram is reasonably symmetric and unimodal with no obvious outliers. So the nearly normal condition is met. All right, now we've gone through all the conditions. It's really nice when our N value, our sample size, is greater than or equal to 30, because then we don't have to find that histogram. It's only because our sample size was too small. So the mechanics of the problem, I have to use a T distribution. This is a T test because I don't know the population standard deviation sigma. I can find the standard deviation from my sample, and I will, but I don't have the population standard deviation. I don't have any information. So we're going to use a T curve or a T distribution. So T is calculated the same way as Z. We have our mean value. So I actually don't have my mean yet. I need to find my mean X bar. Okay, so we go to stat, over to calculate. One var stats. I have my list in L2. I don't need a frequency list. Calculate. Okay, so my X bar is 306.25, and my standard deviation S of X is 29.31. Now my T value is going to be 306.25 minus my assumed value of mu at 300 from our null hypothesis, divided by 29.31 over the square root of our n, which was 12. We type that in our calculator, I get approximately 0.74. My degrees of freedom is n, which is 12 minus 1, which is 11. Now, to find the probability, so if we think about what's going on, I have 300 as my assumed null hypothesis value for my mean. I got 306.25. I want to figure out what's the probability of that or something more rare happening. This is the same as the probability that T is greater than or equal to 0.74. So to find the probability that our T value is greater than or equal to 0.74, we can use the calculator function TCDF, or I can use kind of a shortcut in my calculator. So TCDF, if you go to second and then the vars button, we can get to TCDF there to find the probability. But I'm going to do a little shortcut here. I'm going to go to stat. I'm going to go over to tests. And this is a t-test. This is a one sample t-test. So I'm going to select t-test. My data was in, let me just check really quick. I forget which list my data was in. My data is in L2. So I'm going to go to tests. T-test, I'm going to change my data to be an L2. My mu value, I'm testing it against my null hypothesis, was that mu is equal to 300. So I have 300 there. I want to know if mu is greater than 300. So I've selected greater than mu sub zero. And I'm going to calculate this. Now, this gives me a lot of nice information. And as you see, it actually gives me x bar and my standard deviation of my sample, which means I don't need to do the one var stats to figure those out. I can run this and then do my t formula. So here, my t, you can see, is 0.739. I'm actually going to change this to 7.739 just to be a little bit more accurate. My p value, my probability, is 0.238. And make sure you've listed your degrees of freedom on your paper. All right, now, since our p-value of 0.238 is greater than alpha, so since our p-value is greater than alpha, we fail to reject H naught. Thus, so if I fail to reject H naught, so now we go back. Do I have enough evidence to support their claim? So if I fail to reject H naught, remember their claim was in HA. So if I don't reject H naught, then I can't support their claim. So we lack sufficient evidence to support the company's claim that its battery lasts over 5 hours. All right, so that is a one sample t test from you, hypothesis test. Now we're going to do one more problem where we look at t, a one sample t interval, so a confidence interval. My formula, so we always start with our statistic, which is x bar plus or minus our t critical value. So I know it's usually z critical value, but remember, we usually don't have the standard deviation for the population, so we're going to use t's, times the standard deviation, which in this case is s from our sample, divided by the square root of n. Same three conditions are needed for the one sample hypothesis t test from you. So same conditions. All right, last example here. We have two more examples. It's a longer lesson. The operations manager of a large company wants to estimate the mean amount of time spent on personal social media during an 8-hour workday for employees of her company. 10 employees listed the typical daily number of minutes they spend on personal social media at work in an anonymous survey. The results of the survey are below. So the fact that it said anonymous means that we can assume there was no bias, people, you know, no response bias, people didn't lie if it was anonymous. Estimate the mean amount of time spent on personal social media during an 8-hour workday for the employees with 95% confidence. Assume all conditions for inference are met. Yay. Okay. So remember, when it says to assume all the conditions are met, we do need to make a statement. You can see that I've stated that right here. We also still need to define our parameter. Mu equals the true mean amount of time in minutes employees spend on personal social media during an 8-hour workday. We still need to name it, just like we do for the test. This is a one sample t interval at 95% for mu. Then I can do my mechanics. So I need to calculate my interval. In order to do that, I can plug my values in my calculator. So stat, edit. I've already plugged them into L3 here. So you'll want to plug those in and play along with me. Then we're going to kind of use our shortcut. So stat, go to tests. And we're going to do a T interval. So all the way down, my eighth one down. And I have my data. My list is in L3. Frequency 1, that's fine. They wanted a 95% confidence level. So there we go. And I'm going to calculate it. So now, before I just write the interval, remember, we need to show our work. So X bar is 106 plus or minus my T critical value. So my T critical value, remember I have a degrees of freedom. What's my degrees of freedom? Well, I had 10 employees. So 10 minus 1 is 9. I have 9 degrees of freedom. So my T critical value for my 95% confidence interval is, and if we go to our Z curve, if I go to 95%, sorry, not Z curve, this is my T curve, 95% at the bottom, and I go all the way up until 9 degrees of freedom, I see that I get 2.262. So this is 2.262 from our T table. times my standard deviation, you can see on the screen, is 15.055 divided by the square root of my n is 10. And then I can write my interval. So my interval goes from 95.23 to 116.77. And then we always want to interpret our interval. Even if it doesn't ask, we always want to write a statement. So I am 95% confident that the true mean amount of time employees spend on personal social media during an 8-hour workday is between 95.23 minutes and 116.77 minutes. It's a lot of time spent during a workday. All right. Now it's the last example. So last piece here. A company claims its programs will allow their customers to download 3D movies quickly. An independent lab wants to estimate the mean download time with a margin of error of only 8 minutes. It is assumed that the standard deviation of download times for 3D movies is about 10 minutes. So standard deviation is 10 minutes. And that's actually, so the standard deviation of download times for 3D movies, they're not talking about a specific sample. They're giving us sigma, which is kind of a treat. We don't usually get that. How many trial downloads must be run if the lab wants 95% confidence in their estimation? So how many trial downloads? I want to know what N is. So our margin of error. Now, since I'm given sigma, I'm going to use Z, not T. Margin of error is the part of your formula for your interval that's after the plus or minus. So margin of error, how much are you erroring from your sample value? So that's the plus or minus Z critical times our standard deviation divided by the square root of N. So they want that to be within 8 minutes. So I'm going to set that equal to 8. My Z critical value for a 90% confidence level. So again, we look at our T curve. We look down at 90%, and then the one with infinitely many degrees of freedom is 1.645. 1.645. And then we have 10 divided by the square root of N. So we've made a nice formula here. Now we have to solve for N. So using some of your algebra that you've learned. So first, we would divide by 1.645. Oops. 10 over the square root of n, and then I can cross multiply. I get 8 times the square root of n equals 10 times 1.645, and then I can divide by 8, and then the square root of n would equal 10 times 1.645 divided by 8, and then I can square both sides, and n equals 4.228, which means the lab needs at least 5 download trials. You can't have a decimal value of trials. You can only have integer values of trials. So if I'm at 4.22 and I need 90% confidence, then I need to bump that up to 5. The higher my sample size, the more confident I can be. All right, and that's it for today's lesson.